hope everyone can hear me. Good morning, everyone. I'm Sukruti Chirapal. I'm a sophomore studying at the College of Worcester, double majoring in economics and psychology. I'm going to be the session chair for this event. So welcome, everyone. And I would like to welcome the first speaker, Helen Nicole Bunkley, to come and present her research. It's titled The Real Economic Effect of Occupational Illness and Injuries. So I hope you can join us welcoming her in.
Hello, my name is Kelly M. Bunkley. I was born and raised in Findlay, Ohio, and I'm now a third year going on fourth mathematics major at Bowling Green State University. And with the guidance and assistance from my faculty advisor, Dr. Li Ling Liu, a assistant professor of finance at Bowling Green State University, I am honored to present my research on the real economic effect of occupational illness and injury, also known as OII. Would you consider the United States to be a relatively safe place to work? Well, when it comes to fatalities in the workplace, there has been an increasing trend in the United States for the past 10 years, where the number per year is above 4,000. In addition, in those 10 years, the number of work fatalities per day was 14. When it comes to non-fatal cases, there's been a decreasing trend in the last 10 years. However, the number of cases per year remains at to be above 2 million. When researching OII, I wanted to come up with some real life cases to share, and I found Jose Molinas, a 62-year-old man who died in an oven working at Bumblebee's plant in Santa Fe after being accidentally locked in by his fellow employee due to a lack of indicator lights. I also found Robert Dietz, who, after giving 20 years of his life, died after a 14-hour work shift working for the municipal government of Pennsylvania. He died due to pre-existing health conditions, which should have been taken into consideration before assigning him such a long and grueling shift. For non-fatal cases, I wanted to discuss carpal tunnel and COVID-19. Carpal tunnel is essentially a hand injury that occurs after overuse, typically while typing, so in an office setting, meaning you don't have to do manual labor in order to be injured at work. I also wanted to discuss COVID-19, since it is prevalent to today, and the fact that people who survive COVID-19 are left with lasting conditions such as asthma and other lung diseases that prohibits them from continuing work in manual labor fields, thus changing their lives forever. When talking about these cases, we also have to consider the cost that comes with these cases, which applies to companies, the victim, and the victim's family. And this cost can be separated into three different types. First, we have direct cost, which are the payments made by the individual, whether it be the company or the victim, to rectify the OII incident. These involve hospital bills, rehabilitation, therapy, equipment costs, and fire losses, the last two of which totaled at $5 million and $3.7 million, respectively, in 2019. Next, we have indirect cost, which is an umbrella term for payments made by the company in response to the OII incident. These include wage losses, administrative costs, and employer's uninsured cost, all three of which total at about $54 billion, $60 billion, and $13 billion, respectively, in 2019. Finally, we have quality of life cost, which are the values assigned to the physical and mental effects that the family and the victim experience. These include house production costs and medical expenses, the latter of which totaled at about $35.5 billion in 2019. When discussing these costs, one would think that this would have a negative effect on a company's image. However, companies have the ability to combat this with corporate social responsibility, or CSR, which is essentially a measurement of the resources a company puts in to programs that benefit their employees. Previous literature that discusses CSR talk about the effects it has on investor decision-making, production, and productivity, as well as firms' cost of capital and financial performance. However, CSR is a self-reported statistic and can be heavily manipulated, thus making it unreliable. So what I would like to consider, with the thought in mind that OII cost does not have an effect on a company's image, I would like to look at the real economic impact of fatal occupational illness and injury, otherwise known as FOII, as well as the effect it has on economic performance and employee productivity. Previous studies that look at at the effects of employee psychology include positive impacts of employee satisfaction, where they discuss how satisfaction motivates an employee's success, which then increases employee productivity and thus increasing firm performance, as well as how general happiness increases firm performance. On the other side, we have the negative impact of employee dissatisfaction, where studies talk about the mental illness and anxiety that a worker experiences and how that negatively affects the firm's performance. What we would like to do is to show that fatal occupational illness and injury through employee productivity has a significant effect on economic performance. We hypothesize that one, there is a negative relationship between economic performance and FOII. Two, FOII is negatively related to employee productivity. And three, the relationship between FOII and economic performance is partially mediated through employee productivity. To test these hypotheses, we will use the three-step model proposed by Miller and Judd in 2005. We first will model economic performance as a function of FOII. Second, we model employer productivity as a function of FOII. And third, we include both FOII and employee productivity as determinants of economic performance. To support hypotheses one and two, FOII will have a significant effect on economic performance and employer productivity. To support hypothesis three, we look at the coefficients of FOII, in which case, if the coefficient becomes insignificant, that means that employee productivity has a full mediation effect. If the coefficient remains significant but with reduced magnitude, that means that employee productivity has a partial mediation effect. And now I will explain my variables. First, we have dependent variables, where we used employee productivity, which is characterized by the difference between total output of goods and services produced and the intermediate inputs consumed to produce that output, as well as economic performance, which is characterized by state GDP growth. Next, we have our variable of interest, which is fatal occupational illness and injury, which is our dummy variable that equals one if the total number of cases is above the sample median and is zero otherwise. And finally, we have our controls, which is labor compensation, personal consumption, and years. Let's look at the results. As you can see, FOII is negatively associated with economic performance and employer productivity, as well as it is statistically significant. If we look at columns one and two, we see that states who had a higher number of cases also had a more hurt economic performance. If we look at column three, we notice that the coefficient is indeed still significant, however slightly reduced, meaning that employee productivity has a partial mediation effect. So overall, we can conclude that OII has a negative impact on the economy, employee productivity, and economic performance, and that employee productivity has a partial mediation effect. And this also means that we have found an exogenous description of corporate social responsibility, or CSR, exogenous meaning that we have found an outside concept to explain our inside concept of CSR. On top of that, we have also provided the first study to show the adverse economic effects of treating your employees badly. And on top of that, showing the importance of workplace safety. Also, this research is to help employers improve their workplace to make it safer for their employees, and thus making the United States a safer place to work. Thank you for your time. If you would like to view my resources, you can scan my QR code. That's all. Are there any questions?
May I ask a question?
Of course.
I didn't quite catch in the third equation whether the productivity variable there was measured productivity or the predicted value from the second equation.
I believe it is measured quantity.
Thank you.
Yes. Any other questions?
So a question with the research. As we go into the pandemic, and I know that you didn't put the pandemic as a factor for the research, what would you project the pandemic, the effects of the pandemic on our current set of employees. How would you pull that into, if you were to do this research over, how would you pull the pandemic and its effects into this research?
Well, when I did do research on the number of cases they had posted for 2020 and 2021, however, the number decreased due to the everybody going home and not being going having to go into work. So that decreased the number of cases that were provided. So moving forward, I would have to probably do a separate model that directly affects those cases and to factor it into these models to see how they relate and how moving forward, if a pandemic occurs again, how that would affect OII cases and CSR statistics.
So as I'm sure, so thank you first off for that presentation, really interesting. So as I'm sure you've been thinking about as you've worked on this research, of course, you know, firms that succeed in avoiding fatal cases of occupational illness or injury probably differ in other ways, right? Definitely. That might impact productivity or might impact performance. Yes. And I'm wondering if you could tell us a little bit about how you thought through those potential problems and the controls that you picked to avoid omitted variable bias.
Yes, we chose labor compensation and personal consumption to kind of offset of those perks that companies would give or compensation they would give for people who got hurt and they took care of them properly. So that way they would not affect our model as much. Yeah. Any other questions? Thank you for your time.
All right. Thank you for that amazing presentation. I'd like to direct us to the second presentation of the morning by Noah Grindel. And his paper is titled Russell Wilson and Mike Glennon, Determining if Height is a determinant of Cornerback Success in the National Football League. I request us all to welcome him to present his paper.
Hi, my name is Noah Grindel. I'm a junior majoring in economics and minoring in computer growth. Minoring in computer science and music at Case Western Reserve University. Myself and my partner, Alexander Guerrero, who could unfortunately not be here today, conducted research titled Russell Wilson and Mike Glennon, Determining of Height is a Determinant of Quarterback Success in the National Football League. So to get into a motivation of our study, it's pertinent to start off this quote by Super Bowl winning head coach Bruce Arians. He said, first of all, you have to have some stature. There are no 5'11 quarterbacks. There is a popular belief in the NFL that quarterbacks have to be tall. However, the Russell Wilson, Mike Glennon comparison goes against this logic. Wilson is a Super Bowl champion standing at 5'11", while Glennon is a career backup. Despite the height difference, there's a lot of similarities between Mike Glennon and Russell Wilson. Both played football in high school football in Virginia and in college football at NC State. Both were drafted in the third round. The teams went 7-9 the previous season. However, their performance in the NFL were extremely different. This research will prove if the assumption that the taller is better assumption is a myth, or if Wilson is just a black swan. Our research question is, does height have an impact on NFL quarterback success? We use fixed effects because the effect of height on passer rating is being observed over time using panel data. Additionally, we'll also be using two different regression discontinuities to see how certain effects affected average quarterback height in the NFL. In our study, our literature consists of six papers. However, just for sake of time, I'll only go over four. In Craig and Winchester 2021, it examines the effect of height quarter performance as measured in QBR, ESPN's QBR. However, they find a positive effect on the height of quarterback performance. And Barry and Simmons, using five different metrics, they found that height does not have a quarter performance in any of the metrics. In Winston Dessler and Pellegrinus, the study looks at the how different aspects of the game of football affects the number of points score, finding that the passing game has the biggest impact, showing how important the quarterback success is to a team. And in Johnson, the 1993, the paper examines the effect the components of pass rating has on pass rating itself, in which it finds that the yards per attempt component has the largest positive impact. So a fixed effects model is used to get the effect of height on passer rating. Two regression discontinuities are used, one in 1982 and the other as a year of treatment, the other using 2016 as the year of treatment. In 1982, the NFL induced the NFL combine. The event initiated the heights of the NFL players being taken into account when they entered the NFL. Second regression discontinuity occurs in 2016 when the Cleveland Browns hired an analytics focused front office. Browns found an inefficiency in the market and accumulated draft picks and rollover cap at the expense of wins in the short term. This approach has been spreading throughout the NFL with more teams using the analytics strategies pioneered by the Browns. Our hypothesis for the fixed effects regression examining the effect of height on passer rating is that there would be no significant positive, statistically significant positive effect on height. Of height and passer rating. For our first regression discontinuity, the one examining the combine, we think that there'll be a jump at the point of treatment, so at year of 1982 in height. And for our hypothesis for the NFL introduction of analytics is that height would decrease when it's introduced. Our data was compiled from using data from Pro Football Reference. The data ranged from 1970 to 2021 seasons. For a player to qualify for the data set, we put some restrictions as they had to be a quarterback and had to play 2/3 of the team's games in a season. Okay, so in order to get two values in our data set that we had to use these calculations. One of them was for win percentage, which is shown on the screen. The other is for passer rating. Passer rating is made up of four different parts. This is completion percentage, yards per attempt, touchdown percentage, and interception percentage. It is also on a scale of 0 to 158.3. In our summary statistics, we find a few interesting things to note. We find that there's a range of height from 70 to 79 inches, but there's also a very wide range in rushing yards from negative 31 to 1,206 yards. Games from season was rather wide in terms of the scale from 6 to 17. And we find a mean win percentage of 0.53, which means that there's a basically quarterbacks are winning half the games on average that they play in our data set. As well, passer rating is found to have a mean of 81.21, and height is also found to have a mean of 74.96 inches. So in our correlation matrix, there's three high correlations to note. The first one is rate and win, passer rating and win percentage, which is not surprising as you expect better performance to have higher wins. Again, and then height and weight, which of course common sense is that a player who's taller is gonna weigh more. And then rushing yards and rushing touchdowns, as when a player rushes more yards, they're more likely to get a touchdown. Another interesting result is just passer rating in black, as there was a slight positive coefficient showing that there might be correlation showing that there might be actually black quarterbacks might be a little better at playing football. It's showing, okay. So in our one interesting graph we found was that this graph of the heights over time. So if you look around 1985, there's this dramatic increase, which we think could be due to this introduction of the combine. And also looking around 2015, 2016, there's this dramatic decrease to what we are, that's why we hypothesize that there could be effective analytics that we're going to check. In this graph, the visualization, the effect of pass rating and win percentage based on the fitted values line and the 95% confidence interval, you can see that winner percentage has a strong linear relationship with passer rating. So in this, we have a distribution of the heights over with passer rating, showing that there is rather consistent average over heights of the passer rating, though just to note that it seems at the lower end, there is a higher average than the higher end, which is interesting to note just in terms of our hypothesis. So just say for time, I'm going to go over two t-tests here. The first one I'm going to go over is height by combine, which was found to be have a t-value. The null hypothesis was that the height pre-combine and height post-combine did not change. This was found to the null hypothesis rejected in favor of alternate hypothesis, saying that height increased after the introduction of the NFL combine. The second one I'm going to focus on is height by analytics, just seeing how height changes pre and post the analytics. Here we did not result our null hypothesis that was that height, the change of height from pre and post analytics was zero. So Our main regression of our study asks is how height in inches affects quarterback performance measured by NFL pass rating. In this, we also add in controls for weight and pounds, aging years, games played, win percentage, if the player is Black, rushing yards, rushing touchdowns, and fumbles. In order to just keep this presentation from going too long, I'm only examining the first and fourth regression in specifics. So the first regression, we find a statistically insignificant coefficient of height, which seems to show that height does not have that great of an impact. And this is also proven because the R-squared value is actually extremely low, showing that very little of pass rating can be explained by height. In our fourth regression, we've also found a positive but statistically insignificant coefficient for height. And also showing that over the time, it's just that showing that height does not impact player performance in terms of pass rating. This is also concluded by the other two regressions, as they both, the other two actually have negative coefficients. The only statistical coefficient was number three, which was a negative statistically significant coefficient. But that was also because it was the simple regression with fixed effects. Also, we found that the biggest impacts of pass rating in this study was age, games played, and win percentage, and fumbles, all are being statistically significant in our main model, which regression four.
I apologize for interrupting. We're almost at time.
The regression discontinuity of the combine uses the treatment year of 1982. So here we find that when it was introduced, there was a significant jump in high average height when the NFL combine, showing that the NFL combines led to a significant increase in the average height of a quarterback. So here's our pure equation for the regression discontinuity for analytics. The result showed that though there was not a significant decrease at the point of treatment, the slope dramatically changed after treatment, showing that that there is probably could be a decrease. This could be explaining a decrease in height over time. So some of the shortcomings we found was limited range in height, as there's only 70 to 79 inches, but maybe could be there's a barrier to entry still. The height variable also didn't have fractions of an inch, so it's like maybe that there could have been a little bit of effect, but that's probably not that great. This lack of data of socioeconomic backgrounds, because you don't know how better players in richer areas normally get better training, but could explain it. And lack of personality data issues, just because you have quarterbacks like Brian Leaf, DeMarcus Russell, and Johnny Manziel, who kind of failed because of just personality issues, and we just didn't have the data on that. And also lack of data on injuries, as players tend to play for injuries, it could explain why they're not playing well. And additionally, pass rating isn't perfect. It doesn't include other than passing statistics, so it doesn't have like rushing or any of that. However, compared to the other metrics out there, we found that this is the best and most accurate representation of a quarterback's performance. Conclusion, we find that there's no relationship between height and quarterback performance. We also find that the NFL combine saw the average height of a quarterback increase, and following the adoption of advanced analytics, there was a decrease in average quarterback height. Okay, thank you.
Question, how did you control for the quality of coaching and the quality of the quarterback's teammates?
We did not control for that, just because it was hard to just figure out different ways of being able to control it, because that would be like a subjective rating, which is what we tried to control with pass rating, because what we found was like ESPN's QBR, we chose that was like an irrelevant calculation because of the fact that there was, we didn't know it, and also just there was not accurate. So we wanted to find accurate like measurements for it, and there's no like accurate measurement for that.
Hey, so I really, really appreciated your presentation. You did a great job. I was wondering, what was the unique contribution that your research adds to the existing literature already done?
So actually, this is actually the first paper doing this type of thing. Other prior research we stated, first two, they actually never examined this issue directly. They only were like had it as a side note, barely, just when they're examining how players are drafted and their success in the NFL. And it was only used as a control variable.
Yeah, thanks for that presentation. Really interesting. I like how you frame some of your thinking about around this kind of anecdote of players who have been quite successful despite not being tall. And I wonder when you think about the theory behind your this argument that height may or may not impact performance, are you thinking of it as you're just rejecting the kind of conventional wisdom that height has a positive impact? Or do you think there might be a countervailing negative effect of height that leads to your null results?
I'm more of the thing that it just has no effect just based on the results. There has been stuff, actually the taller quarterbacks and that thing, they have not been successful. I know that it was like Mike Glennon, Brock Osweiler. There's not a single one who has been successful in that like tall category. So there's possibly a answer to that. Maybe there is, but for just based on the study also, cause it's just really, the data for height is really skewed in the middle. So there's possibly it could be a negative, but it would need more like data to be able to tell. That, I guess that's all.
Thank you for that presentation, Noah. I would now like to invite our final speaker for this room this morning, Mark Walker from Oberlin College. The research focuses on informal payments and willingness to extract evidence from Central Asia. Do we have Mark here?
Yes, hi. I'm here virtually. So thank you so much. So the issue of corruption is extremely significant, especially in developing countries. For example, this £5 million mansion was able to be constructed for the son of the former president of Kyrgyzstan due to the amount of corrupt extraction he'd been able to leech out of his country. While this elite level corruption is extremely ruthless and extremely difficult to track, lower level corruption, which is equally difficult to track, there's more of an open question about whether officials at that level are indeed simply maximizing the amount of extraction they can engage in, or whether they are more trying to make up for salary disparities between the public and private sectors in a lot of these countries. In general, corruption's effect on efficiency, in some cases, it's been found to have a positive effect, for example, allowing companies to avoid red tape. So there's real reason for people to engage in corruption. But in other cases, corruption seems to have more of a sanding of the gears effect. Studies have explored how corruption responds to changes in monitoring costs and changes in market structure, but capacity for extraction is usually incredibly difficult to measure. How do you measure how much people could actually be taking in corrupt payments and then compare that to their actual behaviors? There are ordinarily also a lot of indoctrinated concerns because there are numerous factors that can impact the sort of system of corruption that might not be well observed by the researcher. These issues are especially important for developing countries and in the context of trade, which leads us to the present study, which examines in the corruption behavior of customs officials in Central Asian countries, these a subset of developing countries. For these countries, each of them has 1 to 3 key commodities that are extremely large share of their exports, although they are not major players in the markets globally for those commodities. They don't really have substantial price setting power. So the movements in the prices of these important export commodities can act as a sort of price index. You would expect that there's a lot of trade volume that wants to head out through customs at the time when these commodities prices are rising. It's also indicates that some firms, in order to take advantage of these higher prices, would be more likely to want to get their goods through quickly during periods like this, giving customs officials more extractive power. Then also that crowding effect would make a promised speed up of customs processing time potentially more valuable for other firms as well. So these commodity prices basically telegraph to both firms and officials when there's a time when it would be possible for officials to extract more, or it would be more valuable for firms to pay bribes if they were asked to. Meaning that tracking changes in their movements can help us to track changes in officials' extractive capacity. So this slide basically explores that question I raised earlier about whether people are simply trying to equalize their consumption or whether they're maximizing extraction. There's also the possibility that these higher commodity prices effectively raising the wage rate for corruption if firms are willing to pay more, officials might extract less if they're just slacking off. This study is done at the scale of multiple months. So the studies that have found slacking behavior, many have been done like interdaily, and some, I think the longest is around 2 weeks. So this would be, if it's slacking, a much longer timescale of slacking behavior than other studies have found. The second explanation has some somewhat compelling reason that officials might want to engage in a lot of corruption in order to achieve it, because as you can see, salary disparities between private and public sectors are quite substantial. In Uzbekistan and Tajikistan, private sector individuals in similar jobs to customs officials are making almost three times the public salary. In Uzbekistan, it's about double, and the lowest, Kyrgyzstan, is still private more than 1.5 times public. The data for this study are from the BEEP survey. Essentially, we're looking at a binary, is it normal to have to pay a bribe, except using less emotionally loaded terms than bribe? We're looking at that question. And then also we have data on firms' extent of trade exposure, because more exposed firms could potentially be more vulnerable, one might think. And also on how long firms report it usually takes things to get through customs. Okay, so I'm just gonna skip through this because in order to conserve time on this presentation. So when we run this as a linear probability model or as a probit, in both cases, the cumulative change in commodity prices, we can see has actually a significant per index point negative impact on the rate of firms expecting to have to pay bribes. And this isn't just a volume effect. We control for the log of trade flows, as you can see. So per index point, firms are almost a tenth of a percentage point less likely to experience bribe extraction. But you know, this is a commodity price index. It moves around a lot. So that is a pretty significant return per index point movement. Given a natural sort of next step in the paper was to include people who refused to answer bribery question about bribery as yeses, because there's concern given that informal payments are sort of a taboo topic, that the individuals who would refuse to answer such a question might just expect that informal payments to take place and not want to discuss it. When we include these individuals, we get slightly smaller but overall similar effect sizes of it, with that negative effect for the change in commodity prices still. So when commodity prices have been increasing, when officials have more extractive power, we find that there is a lower rate of firms expecting to have to make informal payments. If officials were maximizing extraction, we would expect the number of firms having to make informal payments to stay flat or increase, depending on whether the margin is exclusively in increasing the rents extracted from existing sort of corruption partners, or whether officials are expanding their sample. But here we see a contraction. Another natural question is, what's the source of this contraction? So that is where some firm size heterogeneity analysis comes in. I differentiate between medium and large firms and small and all in micro firms. So small and micro firms, I use a dummy variable with small and micro firms set equal to 0, and medium and large firms set equal to 1. And then also check interacting this with commodity prices. Here, using our cumulative change of commodity prices over the previous quarter and the maximum period-to-period consecutive change in commodity prices, which was chosen since it's another highly salient metric likely to influence firms' perceptions of what's normal. And when we include this, both of these measures, and include both of them interacted with the dummy variable for whether it's a relatively larger firm, we see that in the case of the cumulative change in commodity prices, the statistically stronger effect when we compare the typical standard error to the typical coefficient size is the non-interacted. And then when we look at the maximum consecutive change, we see that when it's interacted with relatively larger firms, we get a much larger magnitude estimated coefficient than when it is than when that maximum consecutive change is uninteracted. In order to avoid to guard against overfitting, in the next model, I drop the two weaker channels and then see what we end up getting. And in this case, we get highly significant and negative cumulative change in commodity prices. The magnitude has actually increased, and that at baseline, the uninteracted relatively larger firms are much, much less likely to expect corrupt extraction or to be victimized by corrupt extraction. And when we interact it, we see that when commodity prices have been rising, larger firms are much more likely by a greater magnitude than firms overall are less likely to report this corrupt extraction happening to them. So this suggests that there's redistribution of extraction away from smaller firms and towards larger firms. It appears that officials are trying to get a smaller number of big scores rather than simply extracting all that they can. And this is compatible with both the slacking explanation as well as with the most efficiently closing the wage gap explanation. All right, so thank you very much. And I am very happy to take questions.
Mark, this is Bruce Follick. I was hoping to meet you in person, but alas, remote once again. Do you see any policy implications coming from this work?
Thank you. That's a really good question. I think that to the extent that corruption is viewed as an intrinsically bad thing, then if you wanted to reduce corruption, you might be able to do so by raising public sector wages in these countries, which is a strategy that some policymakers have suggested. There's a question, one of the questions that comes up with that is whether it would change the effectiveness of corruption to raise people's wages, because in the current condition, there is an effect where when corruption is occurring less, we see it takes on average longer for things to go through customs. That's the top coefficient here. We can see that commodity price index having a positive effect, even controlling for trade flows. So whether that inefficiency would be cut down on by raising wages in the same way that corruption cuts down on it is an open question. But overall, if you want to reduce corruption, raising officials' wages might be an effective way to encourage them to be lazier about extracting corrupt payments or reassure them that there's less of a wage gap they need to close.
I'll go ahead. Thanks so much for the presentation. This is less of a question, more of just a suggestion in the spirit of networking and making connections during this conference. This connects to your answer to the last question about the importance of potentially a policy that would improve the earnings of public officials as a way of countering corruption or bribery. There is a presentation by Kate Yorty in session 4 today that uses an experiment to address that exact same question, and it's kind of contextualized in the context of Russian history. So something you might want to check out and maybe talk to Kate about to continue this work. So just a suggestion. Thanks again.
Yeah, very interesting. Thank you so much.
Thank you for that presentation. It was very interesting to learn about it. If no one has any further questions, I would like to open up the floor for any comments, suggestions, advice, and then maybe we can perhaps wrap this up. All right, then. Thank you all for joining us today. It was amazing to learn about all your amazing research that you've been doing, and I hope to connect with you soon. Thank you very much.